quick survey first. How many of you have actually purchased from Zappos before? Oh, very cool. And have any of you gone on the Zappos tour yet at our campus here? Okay. So we actually offer tours to the public, and hopefully you guys will get a chance that didn't raise your hand to tour our new headquarters. We just moved downtown a few blocks from here into the former City Hall. We moved from Henderson, which is a suburb of Vegas, and a few years ago, I was actually giving a tour to an executive from one of the major record labels, and usually when I do the survey to a random crowd, the ratio is actually about 2-to-1 women to men, and a lot of guys I ask off the street will say they haven't personally shopped from us, but their wives or significant others have, and a lot of times it's actually on their behalf. So I asked the same question to this executive from the major record label, and he said no, he hadn't personally shopped from us, but he suspected his wife had, because these white boxes would show up on his doorstep, and then they'd disappear, and he had no idea what was going on with them, and he didn't know if she was buying shoes, returning them, exchanging them, and every time he asked her, she would just flat out refuse to answer him and change the subject. And so back at our old offices, the building I'm in, I sit amongst the merchandising team, so we went through the merchandising area, and then we went upstairs to our customer loyalty team, which is our name for our call center. And when you come to her, you'll see that we have this whiteboard where we list all the different stats for our call center. Number of phone calls we answered in 20 seconds or less, sales through the call center, and so on. And as I'm going through these different stats, I turn around, and he's disappeared. And I'm like, oh, that's kind of weird. And I backtrack looking for him. And I finally find him. Turns out he had gone halfway down one of our aisles, sat down next to one of our customer service reps, and forced her to pull up his wife's account. And he discovered that she had spent over $62,000 in her lifetime. So hopefully we weren't instrumental to any divorce proceedings or anything like that. So this being a tech conference, I assume almost all of you have heard of Zappos. Real briefly, we're at about 1,500 employees right now. Grew from no sales in 99 to 2008 was the first year we hit $1 billion in gross merchandise sales, and we've grown a lot since then. And internally, we really just, people know us for shoes because that's how we started. But we're hoping 10 years from now, people won't even recognize that Zappos started out with shoes. And in fact, today we sell a lot more than shoes. We sell clothing and handbags and other product categories. And internally, we have a saying that we're a service company that just happens to sell shoes. And you can imagine maybe 10 years from now, there's a Zappos Airlines or a Zappos Hotel that's just about the very best customer service and customer experience. And so for all of this focus on customer service as being part of our brand, the number one priority of the company is actually not customer service. Our number one priority is company culture, and our belief is that if we get the culture right, then most of the other stuff like delivering great customer service or building a long-term enduring brand or business will just be a natural byproduct of that. Many of you have probably heard we were actually acquired by Amazon about 4 years ago. But it's actually very different from most of their other acquisitions. And most of their other acquisitions that I know of, I think the plan is to integrate the company being acquired into the parent company, and then over time the original company kind of joins the mothership. Whereas for us, as a precondition for even considering the deal, we told them we'd only do it if we could keep the Zappos brand and culture independent and continue to run it the way that makes the most sense for our culture. And happy to report 4 years later that they've remained true to their word. And so from our point of view, it's basically as if we just swapped out our previous board of directors with the new one that happens to be Amazon. So with all this focus on company culture, as we grew over the years in Henderson, when we're spread amongst three different buildings, that actually had a big impact on our culture. The people at the top of the hill never saw the people at the bottom of the hill. And so we had actually been looking for, I'd say at least the past 7 or 8 years, for a place to build a campus that we could call our permanent headquarters. And in all of the Vegas Valley, including all the suburbs, it was actually surprisingly hard to find land, a building that could house all of us and where we had enough land to expand upon. And then a few years ago, we actually found out that, and this is what our Henderson offices used to look like, a few years ago was when we found out about the city building a new city hall. And this is the former city hall, and we were really excited and realized that this was actually going to be, could be our future home. And and we announced that we were going to move downtown. This building actually can fit about 2,000 employees, and there's plenty of land to expand upon. So super excited about finally being able to have everyone under one roof. And so we emailed our employees and asked everyone, what do you want in your dream campus? And we got all sorts of responses back. And we just had our ribbon cutting about a month ago, which was pretty exciting. We actually broke a new world record. We had a mile-long ribbon, and then it was most simultaneous number of people cutting a ribbon. We had over 1,500 people doing the ribbon cutting. And then someone decided it was a good idea to do a happy hour with everyone running around with scissors afterwards. Prior to the City Hall deal, myself and a few other Zappos folks actually started touring the different great corporate campuses out there. We toured Nike and Google and Apple. And I remember at Nike, they had this running track that goes around one of their buildings. And in another building, they actually had an on-site pub. And we thought to ourselves, we need one of those. And so then we started getting requests from different employees, and they wanted an on-site gym, an on-site pub, and so on. And as we started getting all these requests, and actually the number one request from all employees actually was doggy daycare, more than human daycare. So... as we started getting all these requests from employees, we realized a couple of things. One was that, like, we literally got hundreds of requests, and we knew we couldn't physically fit everyone under all those requests under one roof. The other thing we realized as we thought about it more was all those other campuses, Apple, Nike, Google, were great for employees, but were actually really insular and didn't really integrate or contribute to the community around them. And so we thought to ourselves, what if we actually took the whole idea and turned it inside out? What if we took an approach that was more analogous to NYU, where the campus kind of blends in with the city, and you don't really know where one begins and the other ends? What if we did something that encouraged employees to actually leave the campus and interact with the community and the city, and we also encourage the community to actually come into our campus and interact with our employees? So right about that same time, and this was a few years ago, a bunch of Zappos employees, myself included, discovered this area of downtown Vegas called Fremont East that most tourists don't know about. Most tourists, when they think Vegas, they think the Strip, which, as it turns out, is technically not even in the city of Las Vegas. Or if they know anything about downtown, it's the old casinos, the overhead light show in that Fremont Street experience. But if you actually go to the east side of Las Vegas Boulevard, this Fremont East area, and I'm sure you guys will explore during your time here, if you go into any of the bars or cafes there, you would have no idea you're in Vegas, and there's no gaming, and it's actually, I grew up in San Francisco, and it's actually the most community-focused place I've ever lived. I've never actually lived in a place where the bar owners hang out in each other's bars just to support each other and just for that sense of community. And so when we saw this City Hall opportunity becoming available, that's just a few blocks away from Fremont East, it was one of those really magical coincidences that was almost too good to be true, and we just knew that the Zappos culture would fit in perfectly with the already existing culture of the Fremont East area. And so one of my favorite quotes is actually from an executive from one of the major ad agencies, is that a great brand is a story that never stops unfolding. And over time, Zappos started out from just being about shoes to then building our brand to be about customer service and then about company culture. And my book called Delivering Happiness, which came out a few years ago, said we ultimately decided that was the simplest way to describe, getting that perfect outfit or a perfect pair of shoes is about making customers happy. And so it's customer service and customer experience, and company culture is about making employees happy. So let's just simplify that and have the brand be about delivering happiness to employees, customers, and our vendor partners as well. And so when the book came out, people asked, okay, delivering happiness, these three C's of clothing, customer service, and company culture, what's next? And for the longest time, we actually did not have a great answer for them. And then once the City Hall opportunity became available, the answer became crystal clear. We wanted to add a fourth C, and that fourth C being community. And so in all the different touch points we have, whether it's with vendors or employees or customers, we basically try to integrate all four of these C's into the Zappos brand to get to that brand that's never that never stops unfolding. And so, for example, we did a skate event, had these professional skaters on skate ramps downtown, and invited the community to that. It was a free event. Employees came and had fun and bonded with each other. But then we also captured that in photos and video, and then that's something that we can send out to our customers and that may be interested in skate shoes, for example. And then in the process, we also get to weave in the story of the Zappos culture and the story of the community in downtown Vegas. So our goal is for every touch point to kind of touch on these four C's at Zappos. So that's kind of the Zappos side of it. And completely separate from Zappos is Downtown Project, which is a separate company. Zappos is wholly owned by Amazon, and with Downtown Project, it's funded just by myself, Fred, who joined Zappos the same time as I did, and a couple other friends. And we didn't take on any outside investors so that we can really take a long-term approach and do what we thought was right. And we have a few different goals. One is to help create a place where you have everything you need to live, work, play within walking distance. Another is to make downtown Vegas the most community-focused large city in the world and probably the place people would least expect it. And third is to make it the co-learning and co-working capital of the world. And you know, most people know, at least in the tech side, co-working, I think, was this concept that started 8 or 9 years ago, a bunch of small startups working in the same physical space. And what they found through that was they would overhear each other's conversations and have these unexpected collaborations. And the result of that was that it actually drove a lot of innovation and productivity with these tech startups. And since then, that model has proven so successful that there are now literally thousands and thousands of co-working spaces all around the world, and not just in tech, but also in culinary and fashion and photography. And you can really imagine building co-working spaces around anything that you can build a community around. And so that's something that we're really focused on helping accelerate here in downtown Vegas. And our whole philosophy from the real estate development perspective, you know, most real estate developers have these short or medium-term cash flow needs or ROI needs. And rather than focus on the short-term ROI, we focus on maximizing long-term ROC, return on community. And then there's also this other acronym that I stole from Jim Collins' latest book, Great by Choice, which I would definitely recommend reading, is really institutionalizing this idea of ROL, return on luck, and really think about accelerating serendipity. And it sounds really weird, like how can you actually affect the luck of a person or a business or a community? But we actually have very real metrics around this, and I'll go into that in a little bit. And so the big bet is by focusing on these three C's, collisions amongst the people in the community and the entrepreneurs from all different backgrounds, focusing on collisions, community, and co-learning, that's going to lead to not only a happier and luckier community, but ultimately innovation and productivity increases. And so here's a quick breakdown of the budget. There's $50 million we're investing into small businesses. We also separately have a downtown project tour, which actually goes through my apartment. And this is actually the wall of my apartment. And we're very anti-top-down master planning. Instead, we want it to be organically driven and entrepreneur driven. And so when people go through, we just ask them, what do you want in your dream neighborhood? And if it's not already on the wall, we encourage them to write it down on a post-it note and put it on the wall. But the other really cool thing that happens is every once in a while, we get someone whose lifelong dream is to, say, retire 10 years from now and start a cupcake bakery. And we say, well, then rather than wait 10 years, why don't we invest in you now and you can start living your dream? And so we have a few different criteria. We want them to be owner-operated. It needs to help build community, that we really care that the business and entrepreneurs really care more than just about their specific business, but actually want to help other entrepreneurs in the community. Unique, first or best is really important to us, story worthy, and we need confidence in their ability to execute. So this is Natalie. I actually met her, I think, about a year and a half ago at the Beat Coffee House, which is just a local coffee house near here, just serendipitously. And we started talking, and it turns out that she was an executive chef at one of the major casinos for 10 years, and actually had just quit her job and was packing her bags to go back to Santa Fe, and because she was just sick of working in a casino environment. And so we started talking, and then she also ran into other folks on our team, and she actually ended up being, it turns out her lifelong dream was to open up her own breakfast and lunch place, and she was actually one of the first small businesses that we funded. So you can actually see here under construction, and this was, she actually just celebrated her 1 year anniversary and is doing triple her initial projections. And the really cool thing about it is her restaurant has become this new daytime community hub. So if you go eat there, you'll and you've lived here for a little while, it's probably running to 5 or 10 people that you know just by eating there. And this is a check cashing place. It was still a check cashing place last year. And this is what the inside looked like. And this is Sarah, whose lifelong dream was to open up her own boutique clothing store. And so we funded that. And she actually describes it as a hangout place that happens to sell clothing. And so people in the community actually stop by several times a day, or they'll bring their laptops in and work out of there. And it's become another collision point for the community. Next month, super excited, and you guys will see as you're walking around, we're actually opening up what I think it's the world's largest shipping container park. It's going to, and then actually this is Ernie, who left Zappos a few years ago. He used to be a Zappos employee. And the reason he left Zappos was to pursue his dream of really getting into, he was super passionate about making barbecue food and barbecue sauce, and would go and started going to farmers markets and so on to sell his sauces and meat. And then people on our team happened to talk to him, and what you see lowered behind him is actually his future restaurant in the container park. And so I just happened to be randomly walking by as they were lowering that down in the crane. And so the container park will be both have activation both nighttime and daytime. That's actually a 40-foot praying mantis that shoots out 20-foot flames in front from Burning Man, and it's kind of hard to see, but towards the top, there's actually an outdoor stage for live music, and there's about 40 different retail options in there, 5 food and beverage options, but the focus is actually in the middle, where we're building a kid's paradise that'll include a 24-foot tall Swiss Family Robinson type of treehouse thing, giant Lego blocks and other activities for kids, and also have activities for kids to, for example, getting a passport so they can go do different activities with each of the different retailers and also learn something there while the parents are enjoying their wine and cheese. One of our goals is to get people to get rid of their cars, so we're launching a bike sharing program. We announced a few months ago we actually placed the largest order in the United States for Teslas. We ordered 100 Teslas and are also ordering other electric vehicles as part of this car sharing program. And you guys heard Andy talk a bit about the tech startup side of things, and the most recent tech startup I think that relocated here was actually a 20-person team from China they were actually on their way to move to Silicon Valley and then came here for 2 days and then ended up actually moving here instead. So it's pretty exciting seeing a lot of these tech startups move here, and part of the reason they say they move here is because of this feeling of community. But the other reason is really this whole idea of thinking of the city as a startup. And how many opportunities in a lifetime do you have to help shape the future of a major city? Partnering with Venture for America, which is like Teach for America, but for college graduates that want to become entrepreneurs. Partnering with Teach for America, they're actually in the middle of relocating their Vegas headquarters to downtown. We opened up an early childhood center about a month or so ago, initially 6 weeks through kindergarten, but every year adding a couple grades, so it'll eventually include K through 12. That's focused on teaching kids entrepreneurship and creativity using the latest research from neuroscience. And then we took over a monthly festival called First Friday, first Friday of every month, and actually partnered with Burning Man to have the first urban burn, and are bringing large-scale art from places like Burning Man. This is actually 45 feet tall, and you can crawl up in there and put a DJ on top. And so part of the reason we're doing this in downtown is because as a culture in general, people in Vegas aren't used to walking. It's a very car-focused culture, and our goal is just every block or so, put something else that's interesting, whether it's something fire-related or large-scale art, and just get people to walk one more block, and then one more block, and then one more block. And that's actually the praying mantis that in front of a Mexican restaurant that we opened up a few months ago. Life is beautiful. I think a lot of you guys are staying for that. And pretty excited. It's fencing off 15 city blocks, which has never been done before in any city. And we have there's a rough idea of the footprint, and we have a video that we're gonna load up. That and just to, while they're loading up the video, just to give you background on this video. This video actually came out in June before. So this festival is actually 4 festivals in one. It's a music festival, 65 bands. It's a culinary festival. There's 50 celebrity chefs. It's an arts festival and also a learning speakers festival. And they all happen to be happening within this 15 block footprint. And so back in June, we had invested in another small business called Downtown Films, and Downtown Films shot this video in which a partial lineup of the music and the chefs were being revealed. So let's play that video.
I've been roaming around, always looking down at all I see. Painted faces fill the places I can't reach. You know that I can use somebody. You know that I can use somebody. Someone like you.
So pretty excited about that this weekend. Hopefully most of you guys are coming. And then if we can get it back to the slides. There's actually another book that I would highly recommend reading, Triumph of the City. Even if you're not involved in anything related to urban revitalization, it's actually a really interesting book. It's written by a Harvard economics professor that studied cities from all different time periods, Rome, New York, Detroit, and looked at why some thrived and some didn't. And a lot of the findings from the research are actually kind of counterintuitive, but it's actually what's guiding how we're approaching things at Downtown Project. And so one of the interesting things from the research is that every time the size of a city doubles, productivity or innovation per resident increases by 15%. But when companies get bigger, you usually get the opposite effect. Productivity and innovation per employee generally goes down. And so from the Zappos perspective, part of the reason why being set in the downtown area and being part of the whole revitalization process is because we want to avoid that fate, and we actually want to scale and become more innovative and more productive as we grow. And we really are doing a lot of thinking of how do we actually think of Zappos more like a city and less like a standard command and control type of corporation. And the ingredients for the city level for that to happen are you need a residential density of 100 residents per acre, combined with street-level activity for those residents to collide with each other, and so all those post-it notes you saw. And the third ingredient is the hardest, the cheapest, and also the one that gives you the most leverage, I think, this culture of openness, collaboration, and sharing. Because if people are twice as likely to talk to each other, then maybe you only need half the residential density. And so it's kind of wasn't, we never thought about it this way, and I never even had anything urban related 3 years ago, but turns out a lot of the things that we've been thinking about the past 14 years at Zappos actually apply at the city level. So at Zappos, we do a lot of thinking about how do we get employees to collide with each other in an office environment. We think about density in the office. In the US, average density in terms of office space is about 200 or 300 square feet per employee. In our Henderson offices, we were at 120 square feet per employee. And now in our City Hall, former City Hall campus, we're actually at less than 100 square feet per employee. And the reason why we care so much about density is because the research has shown that if you sit twice as far away from someone in an office environment, you don't see them half as often. You see them half as often squared, so a quarter as often. And similar concepts apply at the city level. And at Zappos, we actually prioritize collisions over convenience. And so back in Henderson, the former previous tenant actually just let employees go in and out whichever doors they wanted on all four sides of the building. We actually locked every door except for the front door. And even though the parking lot's in back, employees had to walk all the way around. It was definitely inconvenient, but actually resulted in more collisions in the lobby area. And then for the former City Hall, it's off the screen, but to the left is where the parking garage is. And the city employees, when they worked here, used to park in the garage, go across the skybridge, and then go into the building. We actually decided to shut down that skybridge, which forces employees, after they park, to go out into the street, have more collision opportunities with the community, and then there's a plaza on the other side of that building, and then that serves as a central collision point for Zappos employees. And so the big bet is basically get, and this is just a partial list now, but basically get all these different groups that are creative and entrepreneurial colliding together in a relatively small space and make sure that they're people that have a bias to collaborate and share. And statistically, the magic will happen on its own. And for us, it's been really important to actually get people from all different backgrounds, which include not only tech startups, but also small businesses and folks from the fashion industry, folks from the makerspace, 3D printing, manufacturing, arts, music, and so on. And the reason we think that's really important is because the research has shown most innovation actually comes from something outside your industry being applied to your own. So we need these cross-industry, cross-pollination things happening. One of our other realizations is that culture is to a company as community is to a city. It's the exact same concept, just at a different scale. And so a lot of our learnings at Zappos, we can kind of try to apply at the city level. This is the Ogden, where I think some of you may be staying. I live in this building as well. There's 500 bedrooms in here, and collectively our group is leasing about half of them, and 100 of them we've set up as furnished apartments, essentially free hotel rooms. And anytime anyone on our team meets someone interesting, we just say, hey, next time you're in Vegas, come stay with us, free hotel room. And what ends up happening is they're essentially tricked into going to the local coffee shop, the local bars, and so on. And they discover a whole other side of Vegas, and then downtown just ends up kind of selling itself. And so so how many of you have heard of the TED conference or South By and so on? So there's all these great conferences out there where there's the value of going to them. There's two reasons to go to a conference like TED or South By. One is for all the content, the different speakers, and so on. But the other value you get out of going to a conference is that if, no matter who you run into at a TED conference, they're doing something interesting to change the world. And what downtown Vegas is starting to become is it's almost like we're throwing a weekly TED conference, but it's happening every week. And the people, visitors, end up meeting each other as well as people in the community. And basically, when out of those 100 people, usually we ask 15, 20 of them if they want to give a free talk to the community, 95%. Say yes, and then it becomes this free, ongoing free content that's available to the community as well as for any visitors. So one way I would maybe think of what's happening in downtown Vegas is it's almost like TED meets South by Southwest meets Burning Man, but as a lifestyle instead of as an annual event. And So you'll see at the corner of Fremont and Las Vegas Boulevard, which is probably the most prominent intersection of all Las Vegas, we acquired a building, but rather than turn it into an easy moneymaker like a bar or a McDonald's or a club, we're actually, and this is opening up next month, it's under construction right now, building a speaker's theater called the Inspire Theater. And the idea is, imagine if Wednesday afternoon through Sunday afternoon, anyone in the community can just walk in and there's someone giving an interesting TED-like talk about something. And we're also building Vegas's largest magazine rack there, and there'll be a coffee shop and different collaboration and co-working spaces and a rooftop bar as well. And so we've actually started theming each of the different weeks, and this month is a special exception because of the Life is Beautiful Festival, but first week of every month is First Friday, so it's arts and music focused. Second week of every month is tech focused, so tech entrepreneurs and tech investors come into town. Third week is fashion focused week, emerging designers and designers that are really had a lot of success to give talks to tell their story. And fourth week we call Catalyst Week. It's kind of like a younger version of TED, a lot of social entrepreneurs. And this is Stitch Factory, which is just a few blocks from here. It's a fashion incubator. And if you guys get a chance, we'd encourage you just to pop in and visit that. And so when we first started this project, we thought we had to invest a lot into residential because and build high rises or convince people to live in really small spaces. Because that was the only way we could think of that we can mathematically get to that 100 residents per acre. And then started thinking about, why do we actually care about residents? And started to break down, what is the value of a resident that's out and about in the community? So you take someone like me, for example. I'm out and about in a, call it collisionable way, meaning in a semi-public place or a public place like a restaurant, cafe, bar, walking on the sidewalk, maybe 3 or 4 hours a day, times 7 days a week, I travel a lot, so call it 40 weeks a year. You do the math, it works out to about 1,000 collisional hours a year. And then this is a guy named Jake, who actually, I met him about a year ago, he had the most successful fashion-related Kickstarter campaign at the time, raised almost $300,000 on Kickstarter. And a couple months ago, he actually broke that record and raised over $1 million on Kickstarter. And so when we met him, we're like, Jake, you have to move to downtown Vegas, because he was living out of New York, and there's this whole emerging fashion scene going on, and we're seeing this really interesting intersection between tech and fashion and all the innovation that's coming out of that. And he said, for various reasons, he couldn't actually move to downtown Vegas, but because he knew we were doing these themed weeks, third week of every month is fashion focused, he agreed to actually come out once a month and do things to contribute to communities, like give talks. And he actually gave a talk on how do you create a really compelling Kickstarter campaign, which a lot of entrepreneurs were interested in. And he's done office hours and mentored other tech and fashion startups. And so Jake was kind of just this random idea that he agreed to. And we started doing the math on what's the value of a purposeful visitor like Jake that actively contributes to community. Well, when Jake's in town, he's out and about in a collisional way 12 hours a day, times 7 days a week, 12 times a year. If you do the math, it actually works out to about 1,000 collisional hours a year. So while we still want people to move to downtown Vegas, what's been really interesting is now we have this whole other way of getting to help accelerate everything that we're working on, and we've been calling that subscribing to downtown Vegas. And Jake comes monthly, there are some people that come quarterly, and so on. And so basically we changed the formula. Instead of 100 residents per acre, we zeroed in on that 100 and made it 100,000 collisional community hours per acre per year, which works out to 2.3 collisional hours per square foot per year, which just gives you a whole different way of thinking about real estate and the types of investments that we make. So if we invest in a restaurant, for example, we can do the math on how many customers they expect and how long they're going to eat on average and multiply that out, and that's the total number of collisional hours that place is generating. Look at the square footage and see if it's yielding at least 2.3 collisional hours per square foot per year. And so by focusing on these three C's, collisions, community, and co-learning, what we want people to say about downtown Vegas, whether they're just visiting for the first time and maybe they catch one of those free community talks, or they're a subscriber, or they're actually living here, what we want people to say about downtown Vegas is that downtown Vegas will make you smarter, which is probably the last thing most people would associate with downtown or Vegas. So I'm I'm involved in three different companies, Zappos and Delivering Happiness, which spun off from the book and is a separate company that helps other companies figure out their values and develop their own strong cultures, and Downtown Project. And we try to weave this common theme of inspiration through the different companies. And I don't think very many people know this, but we actually just passed the threshold in human history. And this just happened in the past 2 or 3 years. For the first time in human history, 50% of all humans now live in cities. And within our lifetime, that's actually gonna jump up to 75%. So we view what we're doing in downtown Vegas as being much more than just about downtown Vegas, and much more than just about even the greater Vegas area. We specifically chose those three C's, collisions, community, and co-learning, because we wanted to come up with a formula that could be replicated to other communities and cities. And a lot of city revitalization projects focus on an expensive sports team or a stadium or having a Harvard or Stanford, and not every city or community can do those things. And so, but we think there's another way. And for us, it's really part of what inspires us is the story of the 4-minute mile. And for those of you who may not know the story, for the longest time, people thought it was impossible to run a mile in under 4 minutes. Or they thought, oh, even if you could, as soon as you passed the finish line, you'd probably collapse and die. And then in 1954, this guy named Roger Bannister broke the 4-minute mile. And what I found really, really interesting is that in less than a year, other people broke the 4-minute mile. And it wasn't that nutrition was better on Earth that year, just that people believed that it was possible. And so if we can make downtown Vegas a place probably voted least likely to succeed, if we can make downtown Vegas a place of inspiration and entrepreneurial energy and creativity and upward mobility and discovery and all that good stuff, if we can make that happen in downtown Vegas, then hopefully that'll inspire other communities and cities to reinvent themselves, and we can be the 4-minute mile for the world. So anyone that wants a copy of this presentation, feel free to email me, tony@zappos.com. Going back to that original quote, a great brand is a story that never stops unfolding. I think the same is true for a company. So I would encourage you to think about for your company, how do you get your company's brand to constantly unfold? Same is true for a city, and same thing is true for a community. And that's why I'm so excited to be a resident of downtown Vegas right now, because I can't wait to see what unfolds next. Thank you.